don't understand. The world is on the verge of social, political, and economic collapse. Stock markets cracking apart. 5,000 Palestinians are throwing rocks at Jews. But the only thing anybody's talking about is one fat goober throwing a broken bat at another fat goober. Subway series or not, it's still only a f***ing game. Don't get me wrong. I'm all for being a fan. Whether it involves quitting your job to follow a bunch of hygiene-challenged psilocybin aficionados across the country in a multicolored Volkswagen, or camping for a week outside a sports arena to ensure first crack at playoff tickets for a team of pituitary mutants whose special talent is being tall enough to shove an orange orb through a mesh net. But all too often, the noble loyalty and healthy enthusiasm steps over the line and enters the realm of the dangerously mentally unstable. Fan is, after all, the root of the word fanatic. And although I think it's fine to emulate heroes, whether they be bass player or bass runner, if your all-consuming passion involves you wearing Gene Simmons whiteface or covering your naked beer belly in orange and blue paint, it's time for the concession stands to start selling Ritalin along with the T-shirts. In theory, there really is no difference between the most ardent supporter of Roger Clemens and that of John Lennon. Except that I don't believe you'd find any Yankee groupie in the stands holding a copy of Catcher in the Rye, even if only for the fact that they don't know how to read. Now, I'm not suggesting that target practice takes place simultaneously with batting practice, but is there any reason why fans have to act like such colossal assholes? First of all, why do these idiots feel it necessary to attend games dressed like the players? Like when the proctologist from Forest Hills wears his tennis whites to the U.S. Open. What's that about? So if Pete Sampras happens to sprain an ankle, they'll know who to go to when they scan the stands looking for someone to finish the match? It's one thing for a 9-year-old kid to wear a Mike Piazza jersey. It's quite another for some Alzheimer's-ravaged geezer to show up in antique pinstripe regalia. The camera pans to him in the stands, and I think somebody went and dug up Joe DiMaggio. A teenage girl dressed like Madonna or Britney Spears at a concert is cute. But a grown man willing to be seen in public wearing an authentic Derek Jeter costume is just f***ing pathetic. The guy inside the lime green shag rug animal mascot costume has made a career choice. They're paying him to leave his self-esteem at the gate and jump around like some cranked up ADD suffering cheerleader. But I'm sick of that old lady doing the offensive offsides hand jive in the field box behind home plate. I'm tired of the morons with the banners and signs. You think anybody in the Mets bullpen is going to find any spiritual inspiration in some misspelled handwritten piece of oak tag up in the nosebleed seats that reads, "I believe in miracles"? If you're that desperate to draw attention to yourself, you'll have better luck falling off the top of the bleachers into the parking lot. I don't think that when Freddie Mercury wrote, "We Will Rock You," he ever dreamed that it would end up as the drunken anthem for every third-rate sports team in the free world. But for better or worse, that's his legacy. Enjoy rooting for your respective team's victory, folks, but take it down a few notches, will ya? And for those of you waving those giant-sized foam "We Are Number One" fingers, I got a finger for ya. Take it and shove it up your ass.
Chasing a female.
Yankees are about to go to the World Series, I'm in.
Right. Sitting out for nothing. If you don't know that the Yankees won by now, what the hell good are you?
Yeah, I mean,
it's a decent point. Yeah. All right, so let's move on with Boomer, I guess.
Sid will be doing a pregame show out in a parking lot of Giant Stadium tonight.
It's not the parking lot, I mean. It's at Gate D, right there at Gate D, right by the bubble, the practice bubble where Boomer practiced on many a cold day.
No. I didn't practice there. I played for the Jets. You must be a big fan, huh?
D.
That's right, Hofstra. You're right, okay.
D or B?
Are you actually a sports guy?
D as in David.
Oh, okay.
D as in David.
Now, Sid has one kind of goofy eye. Have you noticed that, Charles? Do you have a kind of a goofy eye?
No.
You made me
crazy this morning with like a twinkle on my nose, and I've been in the bathroom 10 times, wiping it off, and there's nothing there.
Like you're sort of cross-eyed.
Yeah. His eyes do tend to wander inward.
Yeah. Well, it was some head trauma, maybe. Once I got hit by a Heineken bottle at the Palladium back in 1986. Yeah, so that may be it.
Dow Jones down 13 points in early going here. We're talking to Boomer about what's going on with some of the families. selling them to people who lost their lives in this World Trade Center.
You know what we did, Iman? As you know, I have this foundation for cystic fibrosis, and a number of my board members wanted to get involved, so I knew some of these families intimately, and they were able to send money to me, and I was able to turn around and give 100% unrestricted.
Right.
And I said, give it to these families for short-term funding, because that's basically what they need it for right now. That's what all this money should be coming in for. But because I believe that somewhere along the line, there will be some sort of airline reparations bill or something that will go before Congress.
To the right center, Ichiro going back, still going back to the wall. He jumps. It is gone! A home run! The Yankees have won it! Alfonso Soriano goes yard, and the Yankees have won the game!
Tolleson, WFAN, 2020 Sports.
Hey, Giants fans, keep it right here tomorrow for Big Blue Football as the Giants host the Seattle Seahawks. Game time is 1 p.m. with Giants Game Day live from the parking lot at Gate D at Giants Stadium beginning at 11:30 a.m. Hi, this is Bob Papa. Join us for all the action exclusively on your flagship station for New York sports, The Fan, Sports Radio 66, WFAN, New York.
If you're looking for a way to add a little spice to the eggnog this holiday, maybe this will jingle your bells. The Dodge Year-End Event, where you'll find a
Giants Game Day broadcast live from the WFAN tent at Gate D outside Giants Stadium tomorrow for kickoff of the Giants-Seahawks game. We'll have lots of giveaways, including Giants mini footballs, NFL 2001 record and fact books from Workman Publishing, and passes to the WFAN special event screening of Black Hawk Down from Sony Pictures Entertainment. Play Name That Giant with Bob Papa or throw a completion in our quarterback pass challenge to win prizes. It's the J.P. Morgan Chase Giants Tailgate Party, brought to you in part by Verizon Wireless, Key Auto Group, and Soapy Beverages, and the flagship station of the New York Football Giants, The Fan, Sports Radio 66, WFAN, New York.
Sorry to say,
yeah.
Today. Did you see all that falderall for Time magazine the other night? 1,200 clashing egos trying to choke the living out of each other in a steel cage death match for Ain't I Wonderful honors. Oh, excuse me for a minute.
Yeah.
Don Imus, radio boy.
Sure.
My personal thank you, lad, for having had the good sense to stiff that affair.
Yeah.
I mean, I like Wally Isaacson just as much as the next fella, but... Well, Jesus, Mary, and Joseph, you can't be showing up in a place where Jan Wenner is chatting up Billy Gates.
No.
Spike Lee's cornered Mikhail Gorbachev.
Right.
Diane Sawyer's draped herself over Tom Cruise. And every politician above county commissioner level is in jeopardy of having a gore hug slapped on him by Jeffrey Katzenberg. Goodness gracious me, gag chum. Lamer than Liz Taylor with a compression fracture. Page two.
Yeah.
Oh, darn it, forgot.
Yeah.
Before we exit the Time birthday bash, menu note for Diane Sawyer. Lard... Bard. One's gown is not supposed to fit like a wetsuit. I was unsure, was it Diane or Richard Jewell in a dress? Well, whatever. But it darn sure looks like Ms. Sawyer's well on her way to becoming her own infomercial. Butt shaper, buddy. Page three. Now, where was I? Had something else to talk about here. Oh, yes. Vernon Jordan. You know him. Lawyer fellow. Handled so much of our president's baggage that Mr. Clinton should give him some wearing apparel, it strikes me. A red cap and a coat.
No, no.
Say, am I losing my marbles, or does this gent, who likes to hark back to his Urban League days, seem whiter to you than Johnny Winter?
That's enough.
Or O.J., for that matter?
No, no.
Whirling around with the President of the United States on that golf cart. Doesn't exactly seem to be the Chitlin circuit, if you're asking me, but you know, Skangle Wrangler, I admire Vern standing by his old pal, swearing in that fractured cadence that their friendship will endure. By whizzies, that's loyalty, Foxhole friend. Cornerstone of character, eh? Just like Bubba and Jimmy Carville. And Bubba and Paulie Begala. And Bubba and Vinnie Foss. Never mind. Well, let's write 30 on this piece of drivel and conclude today's effort. Mr. Jordan, it truly is a grand jury. Just get out there and win one for the zipper. Oh, speaking of that, yeah. Now that gay fellows are declared fit for service in our Boy Scout groups, if the Scoutmaster announces, "I just pitched a tent," do we call a cop? Paul Harvey, good day.
Now, over from the Archdiocese, here on the Iverson Wayne program, is John Cardinal O'Connor. Good morning, Cardinal O'Connor.
Good morning, Cardinal. Smuck out
of the way. That would be fine. Come on here.
Cardinal's not happy today, eh, Mr. Marg?
What's the matter?
First off, I'm here looking at you. That's one. Just smuck you. Still ticked off about that bagel-eating blasphemous baseball owner's scheduling an open day on Good Friday, be Jesus.
Well?
Bloody travesty. Take me out to the ball game? I don't think so, eh, Mr. Marg? Just as soon sit home and watch the movie Yentl.
What?
Sniff one of Wolf's filthy underpanties.
Now, come on, we just don't.
I'm going to sweat the whole Yankee Stadium and collapsing those hot dog eating heathens on opening day, Mr. Marg. Including our speech impaired mayor, God forgive me, be Jesus. Never go to a baseball game again. Baseball sucks.
Yeah, well, that's fine.
Bunch of tobacco chewing chumps who stuff their cups with rosin bags, no doubt, hey, Mr. Marg. Plus, the beer sucks, and I'm with you, McCord, on this.
Yeah.
Too many dirty looking Dominicans in the game today, be Jesus. Stay home and choke up on my own bat. I'll do that, hey, Mr. Marg. The winning numbers in the New York State Lottery is as follows.
Go out of there.
Good.
The Daily Number.
Yes. What is it?
Let me just say this about that pig Bill Clinton, Mr. Marg.
What is the number?
Taking communion in a Catholic church in Africa.
Mm-hmm.
I tell you what, Mr. Marg, a sacrilegious photo op that it was. If he'd come up to the cardinal over at the cathedral, stand in line, wait for communion, it wouldn't be a wafer he'd be shoving in his mouth, I tell you that. See how he likes that. Am I right, McCord? Am I right, McPhail, you little dirtbag, you? Go on ahead. Think of the whole schmuck you. Well, Mr. Marg.
Yeah.
The win for number.
Okay, what are the win for numbers?
Look for that, Mr. Marg.
We didn't get the daily numbers, no, you may remember.
Okay. What if they give you 6 inches or some damn thing?
Oh, come on.
Well, Mr. Marg, though it's a great thing. Listening to you drone on about the ranch and all its attendant bull shenanigans.
What scared me there?
God. I did think of two things listening to you, Mr. Marg.
Mm.
First, I thought of cutting off both my ears, be Jesus.
Yeah.
That happened. Second, I thought it'd be great to bring this story to primetime television, Mr. Marg.
Uh-huh.
Be an inspirational thing. Raise lots of shekels for you and your bagel-eating suit bosses, be Jesus.
Yeah.
It's sort of like that Angel show on CBS. Mm-hmm. Be about the eye man who goes about life doing good deeds for sick kids in the community.
Yeah.
With these two flunkies, Chuck and Fred.
Yeah.
We'd call it Touched by an A-hole, be Jesus. I smell big ratings. Am I right, McCarthy?
Is that funny, Charles?
Yeah. No, I'm Touched by an A-hole, be Jesus.
Why aren't we laughing a lot?
Suzanne Ray falling off her couch at this point. Well, congratulations, Amos Amard.
Yeah.
And you and Mrs. Amos being pregnant with a baby boy.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any idea how it happened, Amos Amard? What are you going to name the boy? Lyle or Eric? Jesus. Take their numbers as spellers.
Come on here. Let's wrap this up.
Which doesn't belong in wine?
Oh, this is my favorite part.
Which doesn't belong in wine?
Which doesn't belong in wine?
A. Lonnie Guineer.
Lonnie Guineer.
B. Pete Hamill.
Pete Hamill.
C. Ibis in the morn. Which doesn't belong in wine?
I would say
Pete Hamill.
Pete Hamill.
Wrong, you mealy-mouthed mongoloid, you be Jesus. Did you say Pete Hamill, Ibis in the morn?
Yes, that is.
Well, all three of these left-leaning children of the 60s, the early 60s, no longer have drinking problems and are more boring than baseball.
Yeah.
The answer is B. Legendary drunk Pete Hamill doesn't belong. because unlike the other two, Pete Hamill never slept with the black man, be Jesus. I don't care if the rains are freezing as long as the Iron Man dies, be Jesus. I'm going to add your smutches.
Cardinal O'Connor here on the
island.
Oh, God.
Nobody is out. DiMaggio up. Score 4-3, New York. DiMaggio batting right-handed, one hit and three times up. The pitch hitting straight away, a long, high fly ball going far out into left field. The ball is over the fence for a home run. A tremendous smash.
Happy birthday. liking the Mad Dog.
Nick, general manager is Scott Layden.
This must be a big event for you guys.
Good fortune for New York, per se, more like New York fans, since Super Bowl not going to be played here. It's almost 8 o'clock on a Christmas Eve on the Fan New York.
The flagship station for New York sports is The Fan, Sports Radio 66, WFAN New York, an Infinity broadcasting station. WFAN 2020 Sports.
Good evening at 8 o'clock. This is Rich Ackerman. Since Michael Jordan left the 3 degrees in Central Park, and that's what's happening. This is Rich Ackerman with 2020 Sports on WFAN, the flagship station for the Imus in the Morning program, weekdays from 5:30 until 10.
Merry Christmas to you all, and a happy holiday season, as we say in the trade, on this Monday Christmas Eve evening on your Fan New York City. Very smooth. Steve Summers here, you there, Matt Deutsch, Kevin Mooney there on the other side of the glass, 718-937-6666 for the Christmas Eve schmooze until Sweeney Murty at 10, right here on your Fan New York. Ivan is a
legitimate son, Rush Limbaugh. Rush?
My friends, in the words of the Iron Chancellor, the great Otto von Bismarck, the main thing is to make history, not to write it. And if I may be so bold as to take that brilliantly insightful quote one step further, the most important thing about history is not to repeat it. But that appears to be exactly what Bubba has done, despite all the new scientific evidence suggesting it was Thomas Jefferson and not George Washington, who was quite literally the father of our country. Yes, my friends, the man who wrote the immortal words, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal," evidently couldn't tell the truth himself. For through the modern miracle of DNA testing, the same scientific process that blew the whistle on our current president and the much younger woman who blew his whistle, we now have proven that our
third
president not only had an affair with a woman 28 years his junior, but that the dalliance resulted in his progeny. In a front-page story in the Sunday New York Times, Denisha Smith and Nicholas Wade report that, based upon blood samples collected by a retired pathologist from Charlottesville, Virginia, Thomas Jefferson behaved back then much in the same way as William Jefferson has today. And although he also repeatedly denied those allegations, the physical evidence also remained. Albeit the stain on Monica's dress was only Bubba's baby batter, while the stain on Jefferson's legacy was a brown baby boy. Yes, my friends, the rumors perpetuated by, you should excuse the expression, oral tradition, have now been confirmed. And one wonders if it was indeed those rumors that made Bill Clinton choose to keep his relationship with the intern traditionally oral. Ah, if only we had taped transcripts of those halcyon days of yesteryear. Tom Jefferson looking out onto the Continental Congress, shaking his finger. Now I want you all to listen to me. I did not have sexual relations with that darkie, Ms. Hemmings. Of her confiding to a friend that she had given him a gift of a silk cravat after he had brought her back a souvenir T-shirt from Monticello and a copy of John Bunyan's Pilgrim's Progress. What's most shocking about the whole Jefferson affair, however, is that the man who drafted the Declaration of Independence not only had an illicit sexual affair with one of his slaves, but that she was his wife's half-sister, which in all fairness is more goober-like behavior than that of the man from Arkansas. For although Bubba has certainly acted like he hails from the Jerry Springer trailer park, one thing you cannot accuse him of is having sex with kinfolk. More after this.
Send in ground troops, if anybody.
Chuck Hagel of Nebraska, John McCain are saying this is a war and you must win the war. That's the lesson of Vietnam. You cannot go in half-cock, half-ass. If you're going in, you got to go in.
Half-ass? Would you say that on a Today Show?
No, but I'm on with you, Don. Okay. Is that all right? And you're a full-ass, okay?
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the morning.
There's a parody edition of the New York Times on newsstands. Have you seen it?
No.
It's really funny. Bill Parcells named new coach of the Knicks.
I miss Kick Stern's ass in ratings. Goes on drunken spree. Deirdre files for divorce.
In the morning. Sports Radio 66, WFAN.
Tonight, listen to our Christmas night NBA doubleheader on The Fan. The Knicks and Toronto Raptors at 6:05 with Knicks tip-off at 5:35. And after the Knicks game, it's the Lakers and the 76ers from the Staples Center in Los Angeles. Your home for the best NBA action all season long. Sports Radio 66, WFAN New York.
The holidays are here.
We'll take people down to play with the chicken, you know?
Right.
And people would complain, saying the chicken got to go first.
Of course he won.
And Colin said, well, yeah, but I mean, it's a chicken. You're a human being. And then the other people would say, when they got beat by the chicken,
yeah,
they would say, well, the chicken plays all the time.
Both very good points, by the way.
Yeah, but I mean,
come on.
It's a chicken. You would think to being a human being, you'd have some advantage, wouldn't you?
Not if the chicken played every day.
It always got to go.
I mean, he's figured out all the moves, you know?
He's done the math.
He's done the math.
And you're telling me that little chicken doesn't remember.
You know who's really upset about this? She didn't say anything on the air. It's Deirdre. You know?
I sense the hurt in her voice.
That was a big deal for her. She went to all this trouble to get the chickens for you.
Oh, yeah.
Did all the research and, well, whatever. Well, I guess the research was just picking up the pamphlets you had in your house there, but still. You know.
Thoughtful.
It was very thoughtful of her, don't you think?
Well, of course. Who's disputing that?
You don't sound grateful.
You don't sound grateful at all.
You don't act grateful.
You don't act grateful, you don't sound grateful. And Deirdre was right. You didn't seem that enthusiastic when you got the chickens.
Well, Jesus, what are you beating up on me today for?
Because you killed the chickens.
You're a war criminal.
You're a war criminal. That's why.
I'm in the morning.
Well,
Elkada, your heart's on fire, Elkada.
Well, the Afghan Northern Alliance is a show in their defiance, trying to free themselves from underneath that terrorist.
WFAN New York, an Infinity Broadcasting Station. I'm
Chris.
Oh, charming.
Yep. I'm not surprised.
You listen to him, you think, well, he might be a little snooty on you. You know, he got that very cultured voice, but...
If you listen to him for a while...
I may be loving Michael Jackson.
He's terrific.
Jim from Owings, Maryland. Good morning, Jim.
Hello, Don.
How are you?
Pretty good.
What do you think?
Hey, I really think maybe Ed ought to be... I mean, Fred ought to be arrested for depraved indifference.
I agree.
Yeah. Yep.
That's exactly right.
Lock him up.
Jail time.
He's a chicken war criminal.
Yep. Hey, I got another question for you, Don.
Mm-hmm.
Hillary happened to go down on Sammy. Do you think Bill would call that sex?
Oh, shut up. Here's Mark from White Slings. Jesus, God.
That's a good question.
That is a good question, Jim. But...
depends on what the word is means.
Yeah. Here's Mark from White Plains. Good morning, Mike.
Hey, good morning, I-Man.
How are you?
If you had the chickens in 18, you lost.
Here's Dennis from Boston on line 3. Good morning, Dennis.
Hi, Don.
How are you?
Oh, yeah. I was out in Nevada.
Where?
Nevada. I was spending some time out there back in the 80s.
Yeah.
And they had legal brothels there. And I kept going back to the same one week after week, and I got sick of the same people there. Mm-hmm. So I asked the madam if she had anything different. She says, go up to the room up there, and she pointed it out. Told me to walk down the corridor, this and that, and she says, you'll see some hens in there. She says, other people have tried it, and they've enjoyed it, so I went up and I tried it.
Having sex with a chicken?
Yeah.
Oh, come on here.
No, well, let me finish, will you please?
No.
So I come out, and I was amazed that something that weird would be that good. So next week I came back, and I said, gee, that was great. You got anything different? She says, well, we have a show this week. She says, go up there, and she directed me, and there's like a two-way mirror, and I'm staring in, and there's like an orgy going on, all sorts of things. So I tapped the guy on the shoulder next to me, and I said, geez, I never saw anything like this. He says, pal, you should have been here last week. There was a guy in there with three chickens.
This just into IMUS in Washington.
Hello, Americans. Stand by for news from the nation's capital. The White House has just announced that the president momentarily will once again address the American people to further drive home the administration's case for the NATO military intervention in Yugoslavia being led by U.S. forces. According to White House sources, Mr. Clinton will elaborate on the rationale behind his decision-making. He will address the nation from the Oval Office, and yes, I see he's seated now behind his desk, and so, ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States.
Hey, babe, you want to go out?
Keep your head down there, babe. Good morning, my fellow Americans. I've chosen to speak very briefly to you at this hour to further define the reasons I have chosen to launch a wholesale death from above, bombs away, look out below, burn, baby, burn, aerial assault on a sovereign nation that neither I, Sandy Berger, Bill Cohen, Madeleine Albright, nor Hugh Shelton cares about, can identify, or locate. I have three simple but critical goals. One, in launching these attacks, to demonstrate that my testosterone, despite the trials of the past year, remains at a level so high that my teeth are floating. Two, to project an aura of such power and authority that America's women, figuratively, and with luck on our side, will literally throw their delicate underthings at me at Democratic fundraising events. And three, to once again reestablish me, my office, and this presidency as a booty magnet. I close now by asking you to pray that my eyes don't roll back in my head before the camera can be shut off because of what's going on right now that you are unable to see beneath this desk. You know what I mean? Thank you. God bless and only in America.
Come here, Daddy. You look so good.
Meanwhile, at the Kremlin, Russian President Boris Yeltsin continued to express deep anger over the Allied airstrike campaign in Yugoslavia, saying if the conflict grows, then, as he put it, Russia reserves the right to take adequate... And then the rest trailed off into something unintelligible. However, here is the simultaneous translation of some of what Mr. Yeltsin had to say.
Where the f*** am I? What in Christ's name does somebody have to do to get another drink around this god-awful place? Kosovo? Sure. What the hell? Kosovo, Stolichnaya, whatever. Hell, it makes no difference to me. It's just somebody poor, okay?
In New York City, meantime, a related story. The Reverend Al Sharpton, well-known activist of the black community, says he's planning a million-man march on Washington, outraged over the use of an inflammatory term in the president's remarks, a reference to the Yugoslavian province Montenegro. IIW microphones were there as Reverend Sharpton rallied supporters this morning in Harlem.
And I'm telling you that if our elected leaders and officials and all like that can employ the term Negro by sticking a Monte in front of it, then it's just a short hop right on over to the N-word. And I don't intend to stand for it. Already had a case of it in Washington, D.C. this year. Don't expect to stand still and have us another one. Buses will be here for y'all in the morning at 4 a.m. No justice, no peace.
What time did you say?
4 a.m.
Also in New York, the city's embattled police commissioner, Howard Safer, drawing criticism for flying to the Academy Awards ceremony aboard Revlon's corporate jet, says his new Ferrari F-350 does not violate city charter ethics rules because, as was the case with the Oscars trip, he was given the Ferrari on the weekend when he was off duty. Commissioner Safer spoke aboard his 48-foot Sea Ray Sundancer, given to him last Sunday while journeying back from his villa in Jamaica, which he received 2 weeks ago Saturday on a stopover to his Colombian cocaine plantation, deeded to him 3 Sundays before last. As Safer put it, what I do with my own time, on my own time, is my own thing.
FM, and you just heard my two favorite bands, Filter and the Refreshments.
Shut up!
I'm a in the morning.
The holidays are here.
Special edition of In the Huddle this Thursday from 1 until 3 with Boomer Esiason and yours truly, Christopher Russo. Then from 3 to 5, it's Eddie C. and Kenny Danico in the studio talking hockey and lots more right here on your flagship station for New York Sports, The Fan, Sports Radio 66 WFAN in New York.
Black Bear Delicatessen.
J.C. Penney. Percent of original prices excludes discount. Details at store. Sale
on your refreshingly eat. Easier to take.
Care to silly powders. Use all this direct.
Sports Radio 66. The Fan. WFAN. New York.
On the Fan. Quarter to.
Sports Radio 66.
Rangers changing. That's all behind the net.
Watch out, you better not cry. You better not.
That's okay. A little technical difficulties never hurt anybody, guys. Don't worry about it. Sid Rosenberg in for you now at 1 o'clock. That was Matt Deutsch. Back on the other side, don't worry about it. No big deal. It's Christmas. Everybody's in the giving season. Jonathan Grunfest is here. Richard Ackerman, Shai Levy. We're all here for about 4.5 hours at 5:30. Knick basketball comes your way right here on WFAN. The Knicks taking on the Toronto Raptors.
Yes.
How you doing, baby?
Good morning, Iron Man. Yesterday, you asked questions.
You wear a turban, Jaleel?
No, I change it with the Iron Man hat.
You got a cowboy hat?
Yes.
Well, all right, baby.
I mean, you asked about who should wear white and who should wear black turban. You want to know the difference?
Yeah.
The real difference is this. According to, you know that Islamic religion divided in two groups.
Right.
Sunni and Shiite.
Right.
Majority of them are Sunni, close to 90%, and the minority are Shiite. According to the Shiite religion, and anybody who is directly or indirectly related to Prophet Muhammad, the clergyman that is, should wear black turban. And the rest of them should wear white. And that's the difference between white and black turban.
That is?
Yes. And that's one of the reasons we have problem in this country, because we depend upon these academic people to explain these things, and they never take the time to talk to some of those religious leaders, which is unknown in Islamic world, and they the one really create all this hatred against us, U.S., and because we never reach up to them and talk to them.
No.
So, and that's the reason. On a lighter note, Iman, can I tell you something else?
No,
not at all.
You have my phone.
You would like this.
You're lucky I don't come up to Boston and beat the hell out of you.
Honest, you would like this. Let me tell you this.
All right.
You know how they talk about we should get to normal situation, laugh again?
Yeah.
And that time is now, because your friend Pat O'Brien did a little interview with Maria Shriver.
Right.
I cut 30 seconds of it, and I want you to hear it. Okay.
All right, let me hear it.
The reporting frenzy as she scrambles to help keep Americans updated on the events affecting their lives. How is the news business going to change now because of all this?
Well, I think that's a very a good question. It's a complicated question. Right now, the news business has a tremendous amount of news.
How do you like that?
Toys R Us has toys.
Jesus, I mean, she's just...
Wow.
I don't know. Well, O'Brien's doing what he's got to do, but, I mean, it's you can't even comment on it. All right, Jaleel, thanks.
Keep it up, my man.
All right, bro.
12 minutes
after the hour, Hassalama Lucky or whatever it is. Hey, it's Tom from New Hampshire in line one. Good morning, Tom.
Hey, guy, man. How you doing?
Come on.
Hey, you might want to check into the price gouging on Cipro. I would be more likely to believe that it's the pharmacy's gouging and not the manufacturer. So you might want to check into that, because it's just like with the oil. When they first attacked us at WTC, there were some spikes in gasoline prices by the stations, not by the companies.
Get off my phone.
No, you get off mine.
No, you get off mine.
I'm telling you right now, get off my phone.
No, get off my phone.
I'm telling you, I'm going to come down there and beat your ass.
You're not going to beat anybody's ass. Get off my phone.
So?
Let me hear you get off my phone.
Right now, you get off of it or you're a dead man.
Okay, you get off of it or you're a dead man.
You think so?
Yes.
Come on up to New Hampshire, boy, and we'll show you something.
Okay, how about if I bring Bo Deedle, Vinnie Pepperton, and Jimmy the Wags up there and beat your ass with your phone?
And you will.
You'll need a hell of a lot more than that, I mean, because I'll go through them and then through you.
Hang the phone up now.
No.
God damn it, I'm warning you. Hang this phone up.
Hey. The United States of America is a friend to the Afghan people. And we are the friends of almost a billion worldwide who practice the Islamic faith. The United States of America is an enemy of those who aid terrorists and of the barbaric criminals who profane a great religion by committing murder in its name.
Here we shall overcome. We shall overcome. We shall overcome someday. Darling, in my heart, yeah, I do believe. We shall.
Ice cream? Well, let's talk about ice cream. Mike and the Mad Dog. program. Good morning, Mr. Russo.
Good morning, Don. Nice to talk to you this morning. Chuck, how are you?
Good. Now, here's this one message. Op-ed referred... Do you know what op-ed means, Sir Chris?
Yes, I do.
What?
I don't know. What does it mean?
In other words, you don't know.
Hey. Making a moron.
Op-ed refers to the opinion editorial page of a newspaper.
Of course I know what that means. Back page of the New York Times in the front section. Go ahead.
Okay.
Sorry.
What's the matter?
No, I can tell you about the Ganami, about the Yankees, and I'm not ready for it, but go ahead.
What do you mean you're not ready for it?
Because you're such a phony with the Diamondback hat on.
First thing I want to know is, did you and Mike take two listeners or something?
Yes, we did.
Well, tell me about that.
We met two listeners who had won a contest. They were the 666th caller. One person, he took her sister from the game at the Garden, limo, up to Yankee Stadium, left after the first quarter. Limo driver was from outer space, a disaster, had no idea how to get there. The power in the limo didn't work, so he couldn't watch the game on TV. It was a disaster. To make a long story short, we got up there with the two contest winners, got there in the bottom of the second inning.
Well, that's not bad.
Not terrible. A lot of security, as you would imagine.
Oh.
The amazing amount of security. But they got up there bottom of the second inning, but that's not the half of it. The problem was the limo driver was a disaster. But we got there, it was nothing.
Who provided the limo?
I guess FAN did.
What did the sister look like?
Young, 20 years old, apparently.
You need to get the name of the limo company so we can hammer them.
You'd have to ask Connie Fitzgerald. She would know because she set it up.
Then we'll blame Connie.
That crack WFAN promotions department.
Anyway, so I'm listening to you and Mike yesterday.
Yeah.
Of course, for y'all around the country who don't know this, Mike is an avid, legitimate New York Yankees baseball fan and has been since he was a child. He was born and raised in New York. Chris, on the other hand, also born and raised in New York, is a livid, rabid, New York, San Francisco Giants fan.
It is.
But more than that, an anti-Yankee fan, and has something to do with something called the Crack Committee, which is a group of misfits here at the radio station WFAN in New York, who all are essentially Mets fans and root to the point of idiocy and psychoanalysis for the Yankees to lose.
Correct.
So I'm listening yesterday to Russo trying to bait Francesa and goad him and taunt him by saying, well, you've got your best pitcher, Roger Clemens, and they don't have anybody. And I mean, and then, of course, Big Fat Roger, who we were hoping. Here's what I was hoping. I was hoping that Roger would give up about five runs in the first inning and would be curled up in a fetal position on the mound, and they'd have to come drag him off. But the Yankees would still win, as it turned out. Well, what happened, Chris?
Well, Clemens pitched a very, very good game, Don.
He pitched
a
great game.
Torrey made the point after the game. He says, I don't want to hear anybody knocking Clemens, and I have to agree with him. Clemens did a great job. He pitched well. Give him a lot of credit. Mariano Rivera, the great relief pitcher, did what he had to do. Yankees were not impressive last night, nor the Diamondbacks, but the Yankees offensively did nothing in the game. And now, obviously, it's two games to one, so the crack committee has to be a little nervous. I don't know if you have followed the pitching rotation of Arizona carefully enough, but the big story right now is that the Arizona manager, who we like, is Bob Brenly. He's a media guy. He worked at Fox last year.
No, he's panicked.
With your hero, Joe Buck, by the way.
Yeah, he's panicked.
And he's letting Curt Schilling pitch tonight, and a lot of us can't understand why you'd push the issue and push the envelope having Schilling pitch on 3 days rest. On 3 days rest.
Okay.
Excuse me. On 3 days rest.
Did you sneeze?
Yes, I did.
God bless you.
Thank you.
God bless you again.
Thank you. And we're very, God bless you. And we're very
Jesus
frustrated.
Loves you.
What now?
I said Jesus loves you.
I know he does, Don.
Okay, well.
I know he does. I'm blessed with two beautiful children.
That's great.
You know that.
How's the wife?
Wife, sorry. Tony was in last weekend.
That's your dad?
Yes, he was.
Mm-hmm.
For the Seattle series.
Did he get to stay at the house?
Yes, he did. No, he stayed at the house.
Oh, he did.
And here's your problem before we get back to Schilling. Breakfast a week ago Sunday at a little diner, by the way, in New Canaan, which I happened to meet Lou Ruffino's future aunt and uncle, which that's another story.
Right.
But we had a christening that afternoon at Jeannie's brother's house. So to make a long story short, Tony, who comes in and doesn't do a lot as far as taking a wallet out, Jeannie says, guess what, Tony? Christening this afternoon, another free meal. Oh, boy. Fireworks at Beach Road in New Canaan. So Tony gets all bent out of shape that my wife says free meal, blah, blah, blah. And so they don't, so Tony doesn't talk to her for the next few days.
I don't know if I found your wife, if I'd be going there, do you?
I wasn't that big a deal. Tony's got a, first off, when you go on a subway car with my father, can he pay for the MetroCard once?
Wow. Leave him alone. Wow. Leave your dad alone. I like him.
Oh, you're funny.
Anyway, back to Schilling.
Back to Schilling. Now, the Schilling situation is I would not pitch him. I would not pitch him tonight. It's crazy.
No, go with the Brazil, or whatever his name is.
Batista.
Yeah, whatever.
Go with Batista and let Schilling pitch tomorrow. I do think that part of the problem for the manager of Arizona, Bob Brindley, is the fact that I think Schilling, who's a workhorse, who's been around, who's been his guy kind of all year, I kind of think that Brindley is being forced into it because I do think Schilling, and he told us Friday when he was on with our show before game one that he wanted to pitch three times. I get the idea Schilling's putting a lot of pressure on Brindley to have him pitch this fourth game. But I'm with you, Don. It's a panic move. I wouldn't do it. There's no need for Arizona to push the envelope up 2-1. If they were down 2-1, different story. Not up 2-1. You are 1,000% correct. So if you're making a point that the crack committee is running around scared stiff right now because the Yankees put a little pressure on us, that's a fair point to make. Is that what you're trying to say?
I guess. I don't know. I just heard somebody else say it.
I don't know what I'm talking about.
But in essence, the Yankees, who are a tough-minded team, got a little life last night, despite not playing that well. They didn't hit. Got a little life last night.
Well, they played well. They didn't hit. The team didn't play well with the Diamondbacks. I mean, they fielded the ball like they were all, like they needed guide dogs.
Hey. Three errors, drop pop-ups.
God, come on.
The Diamondbacks didn't do a very good job defensively. The catcher was terrible. Womack at shortstop
was a disaster.
Tight as a drum. You're right. So the Arizona, for the first time in this series, showed a little fracture there in the armor. So I'm a little worried about Arizona, and I don't like Schilling pitching tonight. So if that's your point, Don, it's a very fair point. I'm a little concerned right now.
What's my point?
If your point is that the crack committee is running around scared stiff and me goading Mike is going to come back to bite me in the fanny, as it always seems to do, it's a fair point.
Oh, okay. Here's the thing, we're talking with Chris Mad Dog Russo from the Mike and the Mad Dog Show. Here's the thing I got to thinking yesterday as I was listening. That we don't want to see this cause a rift, to reopen the festering wound of animosity that existed between you and Francesa.
Oh, God forbid you ever want to see that, right?
Because you guys have been getting... because you guys have been getting along great.
We have.
And that's a better show to listen to when you guys are getting along, frankly.
Mike and I are on a very high level as far as the kinship is concerned. So, I agree with you 1,000%.
But if the Yankees lose and you go on about it too much, that could cause a problem.
Well, plus the fact that the Yankees win and I get a little annoyed, that could cause a problem too, right?
That's not more important when you get angry. It's more important if Mike gets angry.
Yeah.
Well, you don't matter quite as much as...
Yeah.
What's that supposed to mean, Baldy?
I think we know what it means, and I don't think we need to...
We want to keep Mike happy.
Well, yes.
Not you.
Not you. We don't care. You'll be fine.
You squawk and scream. Who cares?
Yeah.
But go ahead.
What was your point?
You know, Mike has won so many championships, and his Yankees are so good.
He lost $90,000, too, out of the track, by the way.
I know he did, and he's a little frustrated by that, but, boy, you gave him a pass a couple days ago. I'll tell you that, my God.
Well, I didn't realize what had happened until I got to thinking about it.
Come on, Don. I mean, what do you mean you didn't know what was happening? Mike had a bad day at the track, and you don't bother him until 1:30 in the afternoon.
Well, yes, but it was house money, and we still got $75,000, so, you know.
What happened to the sports...
Well, he's kind of the sports candy striper now.
He knows his horse racing better than anybody. But
he lost $90,000. What do you mean better than anybody?
Anybody, you know, that's the problem with horse racing, Don. They're animals. You have no idea. It's very difficult to predict. You know, Officer is supposed to be a great horse, and I've heard that about Point Given. I heard that about Pegasus. I heard about that Arazi. These horses are horses. You have no idea how they, you know, if they're going to feel like running that day. But I think your point is, I think the other point about the Yankees winning a championship, and if they lose, we might get upset, or if they win, will I get upset? You know, I've dealt with it for 5 years, so another championship, I mean, how many times can you beat me down? The Yankees win every year. I never win.
No, but if they lose and you go on too much about it and rub it in with Mike, then Mike will get angry.
Am I allowed to have some fun with it, or do I have to lay off completely?
What do you think, Charlie?
Well, I think you just have to moderate your fun.
I think you're allowed to have a little fun, but I just don't think you can just go on, oh, baby, and be screaming. And I think you can get it out, and then I think you... Because, you know, Mike is very prickly.
Well, you know. That's his favorite team. You got to allow him to be that way. But I don't think Mike will be as bad as you think.
Well?
Partly because he's won so many championships.
Well, partly also because Mike,
go ahead.
I'm sorry, you go ahead.
Well, I mean, I think it's all the Yankee fans. I don't think it's so much just Mike. I think all the Yankee fans will be a little annoyed at me and will blame it on me. It's funny. When I'm in that stadium and the Yankees are winning, and let's say I go to the bathroom or go get a Coke or get a hot dog, they love me. Oh, dog, how you doing? Love the crack committee. Where's Mike? Go Yankees. Love me. When I'm ever in that stadium and the Yankees are losing, like game three in Seattle and the Yankees got killed 14-3, I mean, I got to run for cover. It's the strangest thing you've ever seen in your life.
You suck, Russo.
That's it. You stink. You're an idiot. You're a bad guy. What are you doing at Yankee Stadium? Get out of here.
Get out of the air.
The same guy the next day, Yankees win. They're hugging me. Where's your autograph? I love you.
Of course.
Weird.
Well, the Yankees are going to win, so it doesn't make any difference.
Well, what do you think right now, Don?
Oh, to be honest, you know I don't know. My feeling is, here's my feeling, knowing that much about it.
Let's get on the edge of our chairs.
Shut up, you bald-headed stooge.
Here comes the I-Man's feeling.
Where's the marshmallows?
My feeling, my sense is
quiet,
that they're going to get to Schilling tonight, and if they beat Schilling tonight, it is over. Because then And the Yankees can hit anybody. They hit Pedro Martinez. They can hit anybody. And they can hit this guy. And, you know, this guy gives up home runs.
So basically your point is the winner...
This guy gives up home runs, Chris.
Yes, he does. 31 solo homers for the year.
Guy gives up home runs.
Oh, listen to Don.
Yeah, he heard Mike.
Where in the heck is that coming from?
For me?
What, when did Mr. Francesa say that? No, Keith Hernandez.
Oh, okay. Sure.
Keith mumbling for 5 minutes on the MSG postgame show.
Hey, you know, he's pretty good, don't you think, or not?
I love Keith. I like to see him be a little more expansive. My guys, 5-second answers, but that's a good team. Him and Troutwig is so good. But Chuck, what do you think? You think this winner of tonight's game wins the World Series?
Yes.
Chuck?
I would say that that's a fair conclusion to draw.
You think the same thing, Don?
Yes.
So if the Yankees get out of there tonight at midnight with a win, you think they're going to win another
one? They're going all the way. They're going all the way.
What, you think they're going to win in 7 games? Or you think they beat Randy Johnson in a 6th game?
Don't worry about it. They're going to win. They're going to go all the way. They're going to win. Don't worry about how it's going to happen.
They're going to get the trophy.
So your basic core...
They win tonight, they get the Lombardi trophy. That's all I need to know about. Or whoever.
Stanley Cup.
Your basic core to me, in your funny way that you are trying to warn me, you are basically telling me, Chris, do yourself a favor. You've got you. The show is good. The Yankee fan can deal with you right now. You have a tendency to be a little bit of a baby, and you're a little nasty. Do yourself a favor. If the Yankees somehow lose this series, don't go crazy. Is that basically your warning?
Yes.
No, hammer him.
If you have any guts, he'll shove it in his face
hammer
every day.
Hammer him. Yeah.
Show some guts.
Don't ever let
Show
him.
Us something. A little courage.
Keep reminding him. Always, dog.
Don't be afraid this time.
Go
think up.
Diamondbacks, baby. Go Diamondbacks.
I think that's what you got to do. Or because he was going around. You know how Mike is. He was going around. Remember when the Atlanta Braves beat the Mets? And he was going around saying, well, now they got to play the varsity.
And also
remember that?
Now the Yankee season begins.
How could I?
Now the Yankee season begins, all that stuff.
Yeah, well, he loves to say that.
Yeah, so I think you got to give it to him.
Absolutely.
Well, 5 minutes ago you said lay low.
I've been influenced, as I sometimes am, by Lou and Bernie and Chuck.
That's it.
Well, they want to see fights. They want to see Mike and I not talk for the next 8 9.
Yeah,
I
don't want to see that.
No, we just want to see a hammer does.
Mike and I have reached a new level here. And, Bernie, who wants to see this show blown up.
It's boring. Believe me, the show's boring?
No, I mean, they got a fight.
It's not good when they fight. Believe me, it's not.
You got to go after them.
There's not good energy in this. Not good energy in the building.
Mercy, dog.
It's not good energy.
Mercy.
No, Mike's not in a good mood. He doesn't come back and talk to me. It's not good.
Hate radio. Let's go.
It's not good.
And you know me, Don.
You're losing yourself.
Don, you think I can handle it again if the Yankees win another World Series against a team in my division, the NL West?
I don't think
you. You think I'll be able to handle it?
Yes, I think the whole crack committee thing is a bunch of jive. I don't think you really care. I think you do care about the Giants. Another thing, that's a disgrace, by the way. You're rooting for the San Francisco Giants. You ought to be horsewhipped for that. I mean, you're from New York.
Don,
you should either be a Mets or Yankee fan.
If you had Tony Russo as a father, and I love my father, you know that. But if you had Tony Russo, and I was in my Mickey Mantle outfit in the mid-60s, 6-7 years of age, and Tony, and I said, Daddy, can I go to a Yankee game? Can we go watch Mickey Mantle? My little Yankee hat, my little Yankee baseball card, Mickey Mantle, my little profiles of courage book that he had.
Yes.
And I ran around that little house out in Harmony Court in Syosset as a seven-year-old, 1966, 67. Yankees were bad then. Daddy, can we go to a Yankee game? And he said, son, shut up. Go to your room and put your Joe DiMaggio tape on. You'd hate the Yankees too, my friend.
You know, I think you got to get over it. I mean, you know, your father didn't take you to a baseball game. We got a world full of people like you whining because their dad didn't take them to a baseball game. Suck it up. You got people falling over dead from anthrax and a world blown up with a bunch of towelheads scaring us to death. And you're still going around whining because your dad didn't take you to a Yankee game. I wouldn't have taken you either, you little bastard. Go to your room, and you've got a time out until you're 40.
Get a paper route. Get your own ticket.
Yeah, well, why do you throw that stuff at me now?
We have
throw
to
the anthrax at me, the Taliban. I mean, how am I supposed to comment to that?
Well, you're not.
I mean, that ain't right.
I'll see you later.
I'm a talk show host.
Read the op-ed page.
Yeah, find it.
Go read the op-ed page. Thank you, Chris.
See you later.
Christopher Russo here on the Amateur Money
Daddy.
Program.
I love you, Daddy.
Chris Russo, one half of Mike and the Mad Dog here on the Fan, WFAN in New York.
3-2 pitch.
Baseball. There's a long high drive deep into left center field.
Yeah, for well, this was going to be the half-century storm, please.
Well,
fools,
idiots.
How do we hold them responsible?
They're the people. They're the experts.
They're wrong.
They created the frenzy.
Right.
Well, I mean, wasn't their best judgment was there going to be a storm?
That was their best judgment? Their best judgment was wrong. They jumped the gun.
Need to be held accountable.
Say
absolutely.
I was wrong. Come out and
that's
say
all.
I was wrong.
Say we missed it.
They never say that.
A public stomping, I think, would avoid this in the future.
Oh, God.
I'm in the morning, 2020 sports with Patrick McEnroe. Keep those teeth in your mouth, Patrick. You could bite somebody.
Good morning,
Patrick.
Good morning, Mr. Imus. You know, I can certainly understand where your wife is coming from, where Deirdre's coming from in this. Because I think I've had it with this, Iman. Would you like to hear the sports report?
I have a question. When is he going to set him on fire while he sleeps?
Yeah, he's dead asleep out there. Iman, is he even listening to this right now, Bernie? Tell him to put his headphones on.
What do you want, McEnroe?
Well, you know, I'm sick of this, Iman.
Sick of what?
I can understand where your wife's coming from. Why she doesn't want to be part of the program, and you know what? I don't want to be part of the program
anymore.
What's
the problem now?
It's embarrassing what's been going on this morning. I get up, I'm here at 2:30 in the morning, I'm here for the I-Man. Right. He goes out on a limb, gives me a shot to be the sports guy, and what have I done for over a year? I've delivered.
Well, pretty
much. Delivered yucks, time and time again. And what do I get in return?
Well, we got banked up.
What do I get, I-Man?
We got banked up.
No, listen, I'm done.
Well, fine.
Do you think I need to be here? If you don't want sports, then don't have sports on your program.
Fine, we won't have.
Just don't do it.
Fine, we won't have.
Okay, I'll see you down the road then.
Thanks
for having me. It's been great.
You're quite welcome. Thank you very much.
Take care.
It's a quarter till the hour here on the I'm Mr. Morning program.
All right.
Now, let's go to Mrs. I'm.
God, what an ugly morning.
Good Lord.
Who is he kidding? His sports suck.
Wait a minute.
All right,
you can hurt his feelings.
Can't we all get along?
Come on, let's be real here. And he fills his whole sporting. What do you even call what he does? His little update of Teddy Mac. His little, you know, update.
Yeah,
this is awful.
I mean, he's awful.
We don't need you attacking McEnroe. Your early parents upset.
Well, the whole show sucks, you know. And then you don't help me at all. It's you embarrass your own wife even more.
How embarrassing.
Come on. I mean, I don't have some agenda like a lot of your guests when they come on your show. They have some, you know, stringent agenda that they have to get all this information that they want to get out to you. I don't sit there, you know, call calling in with some agenda.
Oh, my God.
God, what is
and
wrong?
Got, and then you help
I might be
everyone
you, Dr.
else that called in.
Hey, Deirdre. What? Hey, Deirdre, you know that bottle you're about to hand to Wyatt? Put it in your mouth, will you?
Oh, God. Oh, this is awful.
Some nerve you have.
This yeah, signing
P-Mac.
How ugly is this?
Well, first of all, I was supposed to do...
this attention to your husband and bringing all this news to his program for what I'm doing, and you have the nerve to get on here and attack me?
I can't see it. What is that all about?
This is disgraceful.
I'm feeling hurt.
Well, you happen to be on, you know, right when I'm, you know, you're in the middle of fire here.
I'm gonna.
But, you know, you have to be honest with yourself, too, you know?
I meant, it's over. You hear me?
And second of all,
get ready for Warner 5 days a week, I meant.
Well, that's fine with me.
Patrick,
enjoy it.
You were supposed to be away longer because then I was supposed to come back and do sports. I never got to do sports because of you.
Yeah, because you chickened out.
No, I never chickened out.
What? You were supposed to come in on a Tuesday and you didn't come in. God. You couldn't handle it.
I'm uncomfortable.
Well, no, that's not true, and you know
that.
No, that
is true.
No, it's not.
This is hurting.
That's a fact.
We don't have time for all that.
Cellular phone, live traffic specialist help steer you in the other direction when you dial Pound Road from AT&T Wireless Services. With reports every 20 minutes, I'm Joe Tolleson, WFAN, 2020 Sports.
Be listening this Saturday for college football bowl action beginning at 3:15 with the Alamo Bowl as Iowa takes on Texas Tech, followed immediately by the Insight.com Bowl as Syracuse meets Kansas State. All here on The Fan, Sports Radio 66, WFAN, New York.
5:22, another check of the New York Lottery Fan Highway Patrol with Michelle Joseph.
Joe, we've got a tough ride on the Throgs.
Grand Director here, when they put their show together, these two morons, he got a radio. He's now the program director over the news station where he's pretty much
Don Imus and Mark Mason, co-recipients.
Each got one of these radios. Now, what am I supposed to do with this radio? I have a mic over there. Can you...
Good.
And I put a tape of their program. Let me see if you can hear it. The beginning of that program. Mark Mason.
I can't.
What an outrage.
I can't believe it. I can't believe that.
What am I supposed to do with this?
Well, I know exactly what you better do with it.
Wait, I got it. Wait, come on. Hit it.
Hit the damn.
Don't you have a gun?
The sports gods were kind to New York with the Mets and the Yankees.
I want a shot.
Here,
do
you
want to
get it?
Freaking Lucy, I like it.
Stomp on it.
Where's that shot? Let me have it. Give me that thing.
Be careful.
Watch yourself, Chuck.
Well, not here.
Yes, friend, we're going to send you 100 baby chicks right now for just $3.95 cash check or money order. Now, just imagine all the fun you're going to have with these little babies. You just lead them around on little leashes. You give them little names. And then, of course, as they grow up and comes wintertime, you cook them and eat them. It's going to be just fun for you. We're going to give you 100 of them for just $3.95 plus COD charges. And if you order right now, your Wolfman going to send you absolutely free of charge a life-size picture of me autographed that glows in the dark.
I'm in the morning. Well, 'tis the season to visit the new Mohegan Sun. Where else can you do all your holiday shopping?
Cruising Bob Gelb. Did he deserve one?
No, of course not if you've established this level.
Yes, maybe he did. He deserved something.
Joe Hollander, did he deserve one?
He didn't.
No.
He didn't
Joe
deserve...
Joe Hollander, my general manager... for 10 years did not deserve radio, but you do.
Absolutely.
Somebody had to be the GM.
Exactly.
Somebody, I mean, he just happened to be the general manager.
A necessary cause.
Because we got rid of Scott Meyer. He got fired.
How about Mark Chernoff? He didn't deserve one?
No.
Hell no.
What the hell did he do?
Hopefully you're in.
asking this?
He was the program director for Howard Stern when you guys were on here. What are you talking about?
It comes down to the fact that you think that you are despite the fact that they had a phone on that 18th of November, who you were very, oh, what a great job you guys have done. I had nothing to do with this, blah, blah, blah. So we all forget that conversation now.
Because
you feel insulted that
you
mean a lot more to our career than a lousy radio.
That's right. Yes.
Right.
Yes.
The
I-Man.
That's the point.
You have a career.
Come on. You wouldn't have a career if it weren't for me.
How about Bernie? Darn it.
Bernie? Yes, Bernie should have got one.
Bernie was the guy.
Did Bernie get a radio?
No.
No. No.
I dissed him more than I dissed you.
So why is Bernie here? Because of the I-Man. He gave one to every Tom, Dick, and Harry.
You gave one to every scum bunny and every... But here's the thing that's most offensive, and I can't believe this, is that you gave one to Mark Mason.
That's the killer.
Program director when we got started.
He is a horrid human being. He's a disgraceful person. He's a backstabbing lion weasel.
You succeeded in spite of him.
Exactly.
You gotta give one to Mason. He's the one who put the show on.
You don't get it.
You don't get it. You really don't get it.
No, here's what you don't get.
Don't come into work today. Get
him off. Done. I'm not finished yet.
Okay.
Are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Why are you so ungrateful? You should be honored.
I'm so offended by this that I can't tell you how outraged I am.
People offended.
Heart attack. You come in today, you're going to eat a sledgehammer right in the teeth.
You know what you're going to eat today, and I think you know what it's going to be, don't you?
What if I can eat?
You're going to eat a little lead. That's what you're going to eat. I'm never speaking to you again, ever.
Man. What does Mike say about this?
Oh, Mike was just dismissive of me and told me that... Mike said, what were we supposed to do, get you an original? I said, yes.
Hello.
Yes, hello. That's an original. That's right.
So you got an ego the size of the grand.
And how presumptuous are you two losers to celebrate 10 years? I mean, so what?
You left the Don Show that day. You called up the 110.
Well, I was trying to be nice.
Beyond great to have us. And
Here's the thing.
That you weren't on at 5.
I actually like you and Mike. Mike's my friend, and you are
why this is so hurtful.
Yeah, that's why I'm so upset about it. I meant what I said. I called up. I meant what I said.
But so not with that, you just said that we celebrated ourselves. I didn't do that.
No, I'm hurt.
You don't even get it.
And you did. Exactly.
Let's face it, Christopher. You are lost.
Totally.
You are out of it. Bad job by you.
Yeah, exactly. A bad job by you and Mikey.
Let's be honest.
This is outrageous. I mean, I'm actually hurt.
Very upset. Don, I'm hurt. Will you please? You know what you mean to us. What, do you got to go kiss your family every 5 minutes?
No, but don't diss me.
Don't insult me by giving me some cheap $29 radio.
That was a cheap $29 radio.
$99 radio.
Whatever.
It took me to track those things down.
It took Terry Irving.
It's easy for you guys to say that. I gotta go call Louisville, Kentucky.
It took Terry Irving 5 seconds to find it on the internet.
Exactly. For Mark Mason.
It took 5 seconds to find it on the internet. You gave one to Mark Mason, who is the most dishonest, disloyal skunk on the planet.
Well, let's get this straight. So you think that Mason...
He's scum.
...put the show on the air.
He's a reptile.
He's the biggest weasel. And he put it on the program. He put it on the air after asking me what to do.
Okay, fine. You just told me that Chernoff didn't deserve one because he wasn't the program director. Well, Mason was then.
And what happened to him?
Mason was the program...
He got fired. Because he's a skunk.
Snake.
Backstabbing weasel, just like you are.
This is not about what he's like as a person. This is what he kind of meant to our career.
I'm going to take that sledgehammer to you when you come in here.
Absolutely.
Director has a vision.
Over.
There's no drilling or dripping going on here.
And if anybody thinks I'm not serious, just take a run at it.
That's all.
Because then you're doing something else.
You ever said give Brokaw anything like that when he was on his program? He's the same age as the I-Man.
Well, there you go.
We're exactly the same age, as a matter of fact.
What the deal?
And then the hot dogs. Are we able to...
Oh, please.
God almighty, it's worse than our Thanksgiving deal.
You're absolutely right.
Get the hot dogs.
Jesus. Think of something new.
Really?
What an awful...
awful experience. Plus, midtown traffic in New York City is just, forget about it.
Yeah.
Of course, my wife did point out we could have gotten out of the car and walked a block to the studio. And I said, what?
Excuse me?
Hello?
I don't believe
it. Get out and walk.
No. Walk.
She must be new to this.
Yeah.
Go get out of a limo to walk.
Get out of a limo and walk. To walk where? Besides, I didn't have my walker with me. Oh, God, it's irritating.
Yeah.
Jeez. Everything's irritating. And then I got a Christmas card from Barbara Walters, who I like a lot, by the way. You know why I like her a lot? Because she doesn't ask me to do anything. It doesn't bother me.
Mm-hmm.
She's just a nice person. I send her vile memos. Not vile memos, but...
amusing.
Amusing memos. And she writes back amusing ones. And she's very funny. And she's... I like her. And she was on The View yesterday with John Warner.
Oh, really?
Senator John Warner.
Interesting.
Her,
yeah.
And that is troubling.
Yeah, that's...
Why do you say so, I bet?
Well, I don't know. I mean, he just seems like, I don't know.
He looks like a dignified old rich guy. Who else should Barbara Walters be hosing?
Something just makes you feel uneasy, though, about it.
Something about it, I don't know. I just think she could do a lot better.
Mm-hmm.
Don't you? Probably not.
She's like 95 years old. You should give her your walker. Barbara Walters.
Well, all right.
The diaphragm has dust on it.
Oh, come on here. Come on. No. Not her diaphragm has dust on it.
No, she's doing better than Senator John Warner. It's a perfect match.
All right. Not that her diaphragm has dust on it.
They both can hold each other up.
No. That's not where we want to go here this morning, is it, Charles?
No.
Or rust. Did you say rust or dust?
Same thing. You know, they both apply.
Whatever. Laid a little 3-in-1 oil with that bad boy.
God, he didn't say cobwebs, which was...
No, he didn't. But he didn't even say cobwebs. No, dust is much funnier.
Oh, my God.
And well, it was just fitted for my hearing aids yesterday, you know.
That's good.
$5,000.
That may help.
$5,000 for these hearing aids.
Yeah, but those are, well, those are state-of-the-art, so.
No.
If they work.
And then Miracle-Ear about $300, Miracle-Ear about $400 or something, kind of
get
one of those.
Yeah, this is, you know.
This is a digital hearing aid that you could, that they, according to the woman who's doing it, you can program. Joan something's her name. I've been seeing her. You've seen her, too.
Yes, I have.
So. Here's the thing about Joan. I can't remember her name. She's her last name. She works over at, I've known her for years. She works over at Dr., she works in conjunction with Dr. Corbin.
Mm-hmm. She's the audiologist.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is she, you can barely understand what she says when she talks to you.
I know. And you're there because you can't hear, so speak up.
And she has a, she speaks in that you can't understand what she's saying. Which I think is, frankly, I think is by design.
Of course.
So no matter what the state of your hearing is, now, Dr. Corbin, I can hear fine. all of the other people in the office here. But Joan, you can't hear at all.
She's pushing the hearing equipment, babe. Come on.
So, in just talking to her, I mean, no matter who you are, you know, you think, well, I've got a problem here.
Of course I need a hear. Fine.
So she says, I noticed you have a gun. I said, yeah. She said, would you like a pair of custom-made earplugs? I thought, isn't that kind of defeating the purpose, getting a hearing aid and then getting earplugs?
Why don't I just remove the hearing aid when I go to the shooter's range deal? Pistol range.
I said, it's a toy gun. It's not real.
Of course not.
I don't need hearing aids. I mean, I said, it's a little joke I play on people. So, well... kind of. Anyway, well, now my hands feel moist and feel my hands.
Must I?
Yeah. Oh, well, you know, you don't must, but well, if you don't want to.
Oh, God.
What's the matter?
They were holding hands for crying out loud.
You shut up.
God.
Actually, that hand, well, nothing.
What?
Doesn't feel bad.
These are great. Well, I don't know who sent these to us, but. Well, I went by. Well, okay. So I sent Kara over to Bloomingdale's to buy some of them. $45 a pop.
Yeah.
And some clown sends me a bunch of them. Same thing.
Well?
These were not the same brand, or these are, but they're...
Same deal, same idea?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Almost identical.
All right.
Well, I'm sure they are. I want to say congratulations to, for some reason, I see this on my list here, it must be important, to Jim Peterson of Albuquerque, New Mexico, Very good of the day. I'm Miss Washington's senior political analyst, the late Richard M. Nixon.
Who heard Imus in the Morning, my cable news network counterpart on your very fine program just the other day, CNN senior political analyst Jeffrey Greenfield. Very damaging, Dono. Very damaging. Why do you need to hear from Jeff when you already have me?
Well,
what am I, dog do?
No.
Just because I'm dead, I'm suddenly relegated to the scrap heap of pundits? Well, F you, you ingrate. Now then, let's push straight into the very compelling matters of the day. Is that okay, you unappreciative, thankless derelict? Very well. Issue number one, then. The co-host of Access Hollywood, Sioux Falls' own Pat O'Brien, now vying for top honors as the worst radio guest since the advent of the vacuum tube. God, by the time he left your program during your broadcast from Sioux Falls, that room looked as though somebody had laid down a fog of anthrax in the place. Was he there to entertain or to goose up the body count?
Well,
dreadful man, and Jesus, an audience assassin. Terrible, seeing all those people face down in their souffles, murdered by that buffoon just as surely as if he'd beaten each one of them individually with a tire iron. Oh, well, speaking of untimely deaths,
yeah.
Congratulations to the Vatican's Swiss Guard, eh?
No.
Finally showing a little spunk.
No.
Those sissies in the pantaloons and knee socks who wear the lace and those inverted cantaloupe halves on their heads. You know what we call people who dress like that over here?
No.
Transvestites. So one of them got honked off and blew away his superior officer, huh? You know what we call people who do that over here?
No.
Postal workers. Well, anyway, most unfortunate. The Pope is said to be beside himself as head of the Vatican State. You know how our head of state handles distressing events over here?
No.
With the now familiar command, Betty, call Moniker. Say, speaking of that, Dono, I know I'm just a little freaky, I acknowledge, but I get turned on every time I see little Susie McDougal all trussed up in those chains, don't you? And you know what? I think Ken Starr does, too. I mean, they do not have to parade her around like that, but I think he digs it. That's why he's indicted her again, in my view. It's a bondage deal. You check the next time they're in close proximity somewhere. If he's there and she's there, bound hand and foot like that, Star's got a bone, trust me. Viagra, don't need it. Get me a recidivist in restraints. What an idiot.
Yes.
Oh, and that reminds me, idiot. Dan Burton, the coincidence is not lost on me, I dude, that this most cerebrally challenged of individuals represents the state of Indiana. For who else represented the state of Indiana? Dan Quayle. Is it in the f***ing water out there or what? Do they raise dumb corn?
Well,
Christ. Burton releases these Webb Hubble phone tapes that have been edited heavier than my tapes were.
Yeah.
Remember the Rosemary Wood 18 missing minutes? Then he expects somebody, anybody, to take him seriously. Jesus. Analyst Greenfield made a wonderful observation on your show that Bubber Clinton has been extraordinarily lucky in the kinds of people who are his opponents. If I may turn a familiar phrase on its ear, with enemies like this, who needs friends? You see, their enemies suck to the point that they really function as though they...
Fine.
Forget it. A most convoluted view in the Dick Scope today, I do, from Dick Nixon, the original senior political analyst and former president of the United States.
They are, and here once again, Chris Mad Dog Russo.
Good morning, Don.
How are you?
Don, is Charles there?
Yeah. No, Charles left.
I just checked, my friend, on this David Fair nonsense.
Yeah.
That Charles thinks because his kid took a couple of lessons from him is, you know, the second coming of John McEnroe at Rollins College.
Okay.
This guy, my best buddy,
yeah,
was a Division II American, was there for 4 years, was 106-6.
Yeah.
Fair was 1 year behind him.
Mm-hmm.
You could put it in a bank. David Fair, if he was 83-17, my name is Gandhi, okay? Not the case. David Fair played nut squad doubles. Charles, you know what nut squad doubles is?
No, sir, I don't.
Nut squad double is when the match is won, they let him go out there and hit the ball a little bit for a few minutes.
Well, now, here's the thing, though.
This is all easy to check.
This is all very easy to check, Chris.
I checked it with the guy who was the Division II All-American who was on the team, the captain, the MVP of the team.
Yeah, but
it was Fair. David Fair is a figment of his imagination.
There must be.
I can smoke it.
There must be.
There's a disparity.
School
here.
Records available.
Of course.
Wouldn't you think?
But I don't know. What other school record do you need?
Hey,
the MVP of the team, who I just got off the phone with, and he said, put it in the bank. If David Fair is telling Charles McCord,
have
how
Dana
was
come
he
in
83-17, Don? We never played any singles.
We are going to check this morning.
Now, come
back. We're going to call the school.
David?
That's a way to check it out.
Exactly.
David played singles and doubles in 1982 to 84 and just doubles in 1981.
He didn't even play singles, Charles.
Okay.
How can you sit there and say he's 83 and 17 when he didn't play any singles?
Okay.
Everybody plays doubles. Rollins won every damn match. You know what that's like, Charlie? That would like be putting me in a game on a decent team when I'm up 30 with a minute to go. Even I can't screw up.
Pat Cooper is here this morning.
Yeah. Let me ask you a question. Your children today, with all due respect, have no common sense. Where do you get off going to school with a telephone? I couldn't get a wire hanger when I went to school. These kids got telephones, they got beepers. No wonder the teacher goes, why are your kids stupid? They don't learn. They got that damn beeper. That's why your kids are stupid. Then they got the summer break, winter break, your break, night break. The kids don't go to school. Why is my kid stupid? Because he don't go to school, you jerk. And you mothers and fathers, don't take him on vacation. Leave him in the yard. Let him ferment for a couple of days.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
You met Rob, right?
I love Rob Bartlett. You know something? I've been dying to see this gentleman because everywhere I work, I need to bump in, miss him, and...
It's not that great.
What do you want me to do? He got the job. You asked
me. I understand that, but I mean...
I don't have a radio show that I got to turn around and say, I'm appearing on Imus. I got to thank God that Connie Francis is still breeding so I get a job.